Hello everyone, welcome to another Kintone tutorial where we can learn coding together. And today we're going to be working with this Arduino microcontroller. We are going to be posting from a ESP8266 Arduino microcontroller to a Kintone database. What we're going to be creating today using this code, the sample code that we're providing, is a locally hosted web server hosted on the ESP8266, where if you enter in your Kintone subdomain, app ID, and API token, and pick your favorite color, it will post that information to your Kintone web database, where you can then get it later for different applications. Let's get started. This little board is the Arduino microcontroller, specifically the ESP8266. And boy, oh boy, is it a cool little piece of technology. A microcontroller that has a Wi-Fi chip installed in it, so it's one of the cheapest ways that you can run an IoT project. You can see here that I'm holding it. You don't need to be too scared. It looks a little bit scary when you're new to IoT projects, but here I am just holding it. And go ahead and plug that in via USB cable. And you should see a brief flash of light depending on your board model. Now, I will say about USB cables is that the cable that you are using really matters, especially with these microcontrollers. Not all USB cables are created equally, right? And some cheap cables are only able to provide power, but do not adequately transfer data. Some wonderful thick USB cables can do both, and some USB-C cables are able to, but don't have the proper protocols set up, especially on the ESP8266 side of things. So definitely double check the cable that you're using. I'm using an old smartphone cable, as usually smartphone cables are pretty well made and have a good thickness inside of them. All right, and that's what a Arduino looks like, but what is an Arduino microcontroller and what can we do with it? Arduino, it's used a lot in IoT, Internet of Things, when you want to connect sensors, LEDs, buttons, and all kinds of cool mechanics to them, just like a Raspberry Pi, but they're not quite as popular as Raspberry Pis, I think, for no good reason, actually. This little microcontroller here is capable of so much, especially the ESP8266 that we're going to be using today, as it is one of the cheapest microcontrollers that has a Wi-Fi chip in it. And a lot of times these microcontrollers, which originally were created for very simple computing tasks, for example, in a factory, like if next item comes down line, push logo mark stamp into it, and moving the conveyor belt and stuff like that. And people realize that these are really good for Internet of Things and connecting material things and getting data from the outside world. And so Arduino is an open source platform with hundreds of different types of boards and different variations on those boards, where you can basically, with a common IDE and programming language, install code and connect to sensors and all kinds of cool things. They're oftentimes a lot cheaper than Raspberry Pis, right? Raspberry Pis are sometimes around $30 to $40, maybe more, depending on chip shortages, while this 266 was $3, maybe? And that's a little expensive, to be honest. So they're really cool and useful, and I feel like once you get used to using Arduino, you might be able to look at some projects and say, I don't need a Raspberry Pi, which has a full operating system on it. All I need is a simple Arduino microcontroller. We have a couple of goals. We're going to set up our coding environment, and we're going to create a Kintone database to connect to, and then we're going to go through some code today. I hope that you're ready for a cool coding tutorial. Let's get started. All right, so the first thing that we're going to do is set up our coding environment to work with the IDE and the Arduino microcontroller. And so if you go to arduino.cc and on the software tab, you can download the IDE with your operating system of choice, of course. I'm on a Mac today, I'm using the Mac version. And go ahead and open that up and you should be greeted with the first new sketch right on here. And it has two main parts, basically, every sketch. You have a setup function that runs only once when you first boot up or put power to your board. And then you have the loop function, which loops endlessly as long as your board has power. And almost all Arduino implementations and code use these two functions. We have to do a little bit of setup, though, in order to get our ESP8266 up and running. So the first thing that we have to do is install an additional board manager. So go up to your settings or preferences, whatever it's called, and open that up. And at the bottom here, you'll see additional boards manager URLs. And here you can add public repositories of boards that will allow you to download libraries for, you know, ESP8266, Arduino Unos, or all kinds of other different boards. Simply search for ESP8266 and like installation or installation guide. Here I'm on the official Arduino-ESP8266 docs site. You can find the board manager right here. And it tells you to enter this into your additional board manager URL. So go ahead and copy paste that into the URL field and click OK. It should start downloading some stuff. And once that is finished, on the left tab here, you have a boards manager. And there's all kinds of different boards that you can install and remove support for. If you just type in the search bar ESP8266, you can see the community ESP8266 board manager that includes all different kinds of ESP8266-based boards. And we're going to install the latest version. All right, that's all done. And then today's tutorial is actually going to use one more special library. We are going to be working with JSON today because we're going to be making post requests to our Kintone Web Database. There are a few JSON packages, and it's JSON. They all kind of work similarly, but we're going to use this Arduino no space JSON by Benoit here today. This is not an endorsement necessarily, but it is the one that I found easiest to work with. And once that has been installed, this should change to remove, and you are ready to test your ESP8266. So go ahead and don't be afraid of touching it too much because they're cheap. And you should see your port to connect your USB and go ahead and plug that in. And once you've plugged it in, you should be able to select your board from the specific port that your USB is plugged into. So here it's an unknown board on the USB serial. Now, depending on the USB cable that you are using, not all USB cables are created equal. And some only have enough throughput to do power and not transfer data. So definitely be careful of the USB cable that you're going to be using and make sure it's a good, nice, thick USB cable. Definitely double check your USB cable when you do this. And here we have to pick our board since our port was recognized, a USB serial. So go ahead and boards. The specific ESP8266 that I'm using today is a low-lin NodeMCU. This will differ slightly depending on where you got your board from. So definitely check that carefully in the documentation. And once it has been recognized down here, you are ready to get started coding. All right, so now that we have our development environment and our IDE set up, the next thing that we need to do is create a Kintone Web Database in order to store our information. So in the example that I showed you earlier, we're having users pick their favorite color out of red, blue, yellow, and green. Woohoo, right? And so we need a database in order to store that information. Here I have my Kintone environment for this app ready to go, but if you don't have your Kintone environment yet and you want to sign up for Kintone and make your first app in less than 5 minutes, then check out the video in the description below. But we're going to go in real fast here, create a new app, create an app from scratch, and this time we're going to do an ESP8266 test is what I'm going to call this app, and it's a choice, right, between four different options. So we're going to have a radio button. And in that radio button, we're going to call it favorite color. So we're going to have four choices, right? Here, case does matter. So capital R, red, capital B, blue, capital Y, yellow, and capital G, green. And the field code, we need to change to lowercase color. Click on save, click on activate app. And you should have a new database. And if we were to make a record right here by hand, I guess I like blue. There we go. You can enter data into the database. And the next thing that we need to do is make an API token, right? We want to make some API tokens. And that's always easy with Kintone. If you just go to App Settings, API Token, click on Generate. And this time we are going to be posting data into our database. We're going to be adding data into our database. So we need the add records scope permission. Copy down the API key, which yes, I will be deleting this after the video is filmed. Always click on save and always click on update app. And you have a Kintone Web Database that has an A token authenticated route in less than a minute now. All right. And so now that we have our Kintone Web Database all set up, our next steps are to get our sample code that we've provided for you and copy that sample code into our Arduino IDE. Then we're going to edit that code with our Wi-Fi credentials and SSID, upload it into our ESP8266, and then make a test post to our newly created Kintone Web Database. We have here in the Kintone Workshops GitHub the ESP8266 Sketches repository, and I've opened this up, ESP8266 Sketches, the Kintone Web Server folder, and here we have Kintone Web Server.ino, and you're going to copy this raw file, and in your Arduino IDE. Go ahead and paste that in and save if you want to. It'll ask you to save, sure. And here we have our sample code all ready to be edited. The next thing that we need to do is we need to connect our ESP8266 to Wi-Fi. And a lot of the code in here is actually handling creating a web server and stuff like that using some libraries. But the only thing that you need to edit from the get-go in this code, if you've set everything up like we have just now, is this SSID and Wi-Fi password variable. So go ahead, and I'm going to do this with my phone and my very secure password. And one thing to note about the ESP8266 is that the Wi-Fi chip in there is made for 2.5 gigahertz Wi-Fi bands. So if you're trying to connect it to a 5 gig Wi-Fi band, then it's not going to be able to connect right. So definitely make sure that the Wi-Fi network that you're using is a 2.5 gigahertz. Now, in the Arduino IDE, you can always verify and kind of test compile your code. If you go up to the top left here, click on verify, and it'll say it's compiling the sketch. It'll check for errors, missing semicolons, missing quotation marks, type mismatches, and all that. And we should see that it should connect and finish compiling very quickly. And in the bottom corner over here, we can see that our ESP8266 is connected via USB. There we go, done compiling. And you can see in the bottom corner that the USB is connected to our ESP8266. It is compiled correctly. So let's go ahead and click on upload. And you will see once again that it's going to test compile the sketch and then upload it into our Arduino microcontroller. Yeah, so you can see that our code has uploaded correctly into our ESP8266. And how can we communicate and how can we talk to our microcontroller? This is one thing that a lot of new developers for Arduino tend to get confused with web development and JavaScript. The first thing you always do is console.log and you look in the developer's tools. And the ESP8266 and Arduinos have this functionality as well. And they use something called a serial monitor. And a serial monitor is a very low-level way of connecting and sending information to and from your microcontroller. Here we have our serial monitor and we're beginning it on a baud rate of 9600. This rate is what was recommended for the NodeMCU board that we're using today. It might differ, but you can always specify it here. And then in your Arduino settings, up here in the tools, you can see that there is a serial monitor. And a lot of times when you first start up the serial monitor and reset your board, you're going to get a lot of garbled characters like this. And actually, this is totally normal. There's a lot of things that could garble the characters, like electrical interference, right? And on your board, or if you replug in your board, if you click reset, you should see that you get different cables over here. Oh, look at that. So I was on the wrong baud rate. If you check over here on the right side of the IDE, actually, you can see the baud rate. We've specified it as 9600, but here we have it as 7488. Which is incorrect. So go ahead and move that to 9600 and then reset your board or unplug your board and replug it in. And there you go. We should get some actual English characters in there. And it is trying to connect to the Sean at work Wi-Fi network. It is connected. These are all just console.logs, aka printing to the serial monitor. And this is, we've got the IP address of 172.20.10.3. So go ahead and copy that IP address. Go ahead and paste that in. And while not secure, you should see that we have successfully created a web server on your local network. This is equivalent to localhost port 3000 or something like that if you're doing web development. From this web server, if we give it three pieces of information, namely our Kintone subdomain, the app ID or which database table that we're going to be posting information to, and our API token, then we should be able to post Kintone. Let's get all that information. We've just recently created this subdomain. So we have the test for Kintone subdomain. Subdomain is what comes before the .kintone.com. I'm going to put test for Kintone in here. The app ID is going to be the number at the very end after K for your app URL. So we're going to see it's /k/7. So my app ID is 7. I'm going to put that in there, 7. And then our API token, you can always double check your API token. If you click on the cogwheel, go to app settings, API tokens, my super secret API token. And back in our server, we click on our API token and copy paste that in. And we pick a favorite color. Yeah, it's green. what you thought it was blue, click on post, and you're going to see the success page. And the success page is displayed based on the response code of our connection to the Kintone web server. Now, this response code, as long as we're able to make a connection, it's going to respond with a 200 status code, successful connection. That does not mean a successful post to your Kintone database, but if you want to debug, you can go over here to the serial monitor, and we're console.logging. We're printing out this information here saying, hey, we're trying to save to Kintone at this URL, so you can double check your URL. We have our response code of 200, and the response object that we got back said that we have successfully posted. If we were to go to our Kintone database and refresh the page, you will see that, of course, my favorite color is green. It always has been. All right, so we've successfully posted to our Kintone database, and this is a good starter project. If you're looking to expand on this project, and definitely take a look at the code on the article that we're providing in the description. I tried my best. I wrote a lot of comments here, right? But the one thing that you would also need to expand on if you're going to save different kinds of data to your Kintone database or manipulate that data is you would need to change the post body object that we are posting to Kintone, right? And you can find that down here in our HTML page that we are getting from our form action. We're actually taking from the form these arguments, and we have arguments of app ID, your API token, your subdomain, the color that you chose, right? So you're going to have to add some more fields into there if you add fields to the form, for example. And then the JSON object right here we're making starting on line 77, that's using that Arduino JSON library that we installed earlier. And if you were to add, for example, favorite color and also your name or age or some other kind of information, you would have to add to this JSON object, kind of in the way that I'm doing right here. You'd have to create a new nested object, for example, and you would have to add properties to that object and then save it as a JSON string in order for our post request to send. But it's definitely a good starting point for your IoT adventures, and I hope that you can make use of this ESP8266 tutorial. All right, so that was another Kintone tutorial, and thank you for watching, and good luck with your IoT projects in the future. We'll be expanding on that over on this side as well. For more information about how to use Kintone and our REST APIs, check out kintone.dev, and we also have a forum, which is very active. We answer your questions very quickly. It's our jobs at forum.kintone.dev. Thank you very much, and enjoy coding.